patient to the nice workshop in advanced school. So I changed a little bit the title just because the ID will be the same in a more simple fashion here. So it's a previous work with my collaborator, which are Nicolas Fournier and Stéphane Michler, which will come next week. It's about the 2D Navier-Stokes equation. So just to comment a little bit the title, the propagation of chaos, I will explain a little bit what it means, but just to mention that chaos is not maybe the, is not in the sense that it's very sensitive to the initial condition in some sense. This is what is called, more precisely, the molecular chaos, or chaos in the sense of Boltzmann, meaning that when you pick it, when you look at a large system of particles, and if you pick randomly two particles among the huge amount you have, then they should be roughly independent, okay? This is what is behind this word of chaos here, and I will explain it a little bit later. So I will start from the 2D Navier-Stokes equation, okay? So I write it. You have a velocity field U, which is advected by itself, and you add some viscosity, which is a kind of diffusion, okay, exactly a diffusion in some sense, okay, and so I will always be on Rd, okay. T is the time in R, and x is a position in Rd. So this is a completely local equation, and you may ask, why we are speaking of the Navier-Stokes equation in this conference about non-local equation, but because of what I will say, is that in 2D, in two dimension, what you usually do is, which is very interesting to do, is to look at the equation satisfied by the curl of U, okay? So if you look at W, which is a curl of U, in 2D, I mean by this, I mean the derivative of, and U has two components, of course, okay. And so the derivative of the first component with respect to the second one minus the derivative of the second one with respect to one. I hope the sign is a good one. If it is not, it's not so important. Okay, and the equation for this one is still, I will write it there, okay, because I need it many times. So for me, NS2D would be in vorticity formulation. Okay, and the equation is that it's more or less the same. Okay, the vorticity is still advected by the velocity field U. There is still this diffusion of W, sorry. And the point is not that U depends on W, and in a way that is non-local, because basically you have to take back the curl of U. And the point is that I forgot, of course, the fact that this is an incompressible Navier-Stokes equation. I should add the pressure. Now, with the divergence U equals to zero, there is a... Thank you very much. It was a kind of simplified Navier-Stokes equation, but which couldn't handle this concept. Okay. Thank you very much. So I'm very used to this formulation, in vorticity formulation, in which you kill exactly directly this pressure term. So that's a... That's why we are very happy to deal with that equation, in some sense, when you do not see any more the pressure. Thank you very much for your comment. And U is given now by a Mill field, okay, which is, there is a kernel, and you compute U according to, I should choose some good notation, so let's say that, okay, for this one. Okay, this is a mean field equation, meaning that when you want to compute U, you need to know W in the whole space, okay? And where K is the kernel of the BioSavart kernel, which is expert over x to the power 2 in norm. And you see that it's a gradient perp of log of x, 1 over 2 pi. And you have this formula. Okay, this is a mean field equation. We mean field because you need the you need to know W everywhere to compute U at one point. Okay, so this term is non-local at this time, and so you see that we pass from a local equation with a new know, which is probably non-local in this sense, and to a non-local equation where there is no know anymore. But clearly, you see where is the non-locality. Okay, so this is the Navier-Stokes 2D equation. I should quote avec some result about uniqueness, existence, and uniqueness, because I will deal about it later. So this is a, so this is not completely trivial, because as you see, the kernel K is singular, okay? It's in 1 over x at the origin. So you cannot say just existence is trivial, it's just a drift and a diffusion. No, the drift is singular. The drift is given by, is nonlinear and possibly singular, so you have to be a little bit more careful. But we have some nice results. Maybe before doing some mistakes, I should send my note away. Then, by, for instance, Bernard Z, following some time ago, following Kato, he showed that the problem is well posed for W0 in L1 among solutions that have some continuity with respect to time in L1. Sorry. Okay. So you need some. I will come back about it later. But you need some a priori condition to give some one posed net result on this equation. Okay, you need to give some regularity of the initial condition and something about in which case the solution evolves. It's usual, okay, but it's important. It will be very important for our particle system point of view. So we stress it. So this is a very good result. And the most recent result is by Lyons, Gallagher, and Gallet. In fact, there is two papers about this one, but where they show that you can start for the vorticity, which is a measure, okay? A measure, sorry, it's almost it's a very general result. And again, you need still some continuity of the solution with respect to time, and this time, let's say, you need some continuity in L1, but of course, you cannot impose it at times t equals to 0, because at this time, it's something which is not in L1. So what you need to know is that the solution will be continuous after times equals to 0, in some sense. OK. It's continuous in time, its value in L1, after time 0.
Time 0 is...
Yeah, at times t equals 0, it should converge to omega 0, which is a measure. Okay. So it's by weakly continuous. It's in a weak sense, of course. So you do that. OK, so let's now speak about particle system. So I should introduce the vortex approximation. So vortex, you probably all know what it is. OK, it's what happens when you empty a sink or something like that. You see a fast rotation of the fluid. And it corresponds to a fundamental solution of the Euler equation, let's say, without vorticity. Okay, which is you put a Dirac masses of vorticity. Okay, and if you put a Dirac masses of vorticity and you look at the velocity field which is associated, It's something which rotates around this point, and it rotates faster and faster, sorry, around, if you are closer for the, the closer you are from the origin of your direct mass, of your, the point of your direct masses, the faster you rotate, okay? It's a rotation which goes faster and faster when you approach the Dirac masses. So it is a vortex is a fundamental solution of the Euler equation. Euler means there is no dissipation, no vorticity, no viscosity, excuse me. And so this kind of object were used, were introduced by Helmholtz and Kirchhoff in the end of the 19th century, because they wanted, in fact, because they see this, and then they use it to build a kind of approximation of the Euler equation, where you need, okay, I would like to say this equation as a, write to this equation when W is the sum of Dirac masses, okay? Can I do that? Is the sum of Dirac masses. So you write, is that, which I will call an empirical measure. Okay, so you write W of T equal 1 over N. You will take N Dirac masses. They have position and they have some vorticity, which could be something. Positive, negative, depending on the signs of the rotation. And then you scale it properly. And if you want to scale it properly in a kind of mean field setting, you put a 1 over n in order to keep a finite sign, finite sum in the end. OK, this is omega n of t. And if you look at this, OK, you want to write the characteristic equation which are behind this equation. So you have advection drift with respect to U, and you have diffusion. So what you write naturally is a particle system, which is the following one. Okay, each particle, X, E, and T, follows this equation, so U. You can compute it by a formula, but this formula, with respect to an empirical measure, it becomes a sum of k of xin of t minus xin of t plus, so you have to get some diffusion. If you want to get some diffusion on the transport equation at the level of the Fokker-Planck equation, you need to add a Brownian motion on the trajectories, basically. Okay? And with a coefficient, which will be sigma, and sigma is equal. And the relation is that mu is equal to sigma squared over 2. If you're familiar with the Itô formula, this is what you get at the ends. And so you see that now we have a system of particles which interact each other in a fashion which is very similar to this one, okay? Because if you plug an empirical measure, so a sum of Dirac masses in this equation, in this integral, you get exactly this sum, okay? So they are clearly related. And the question is, what can we do with that kind of system? Okay, what about existence and uniqueness? For this SDE, this is a stochastic differential equation because of the presence of this Brownian motion. Again, this is not so easy, okay, because of the singularity of the kernel. Yeah. Just a short question on this. I have to. Ah, yeah, you're right. Completely right. Thanks a lot. K is not defined at zero. Okay, there is no self-interaction among the vortices, so you cannot see this one. In fact, maybe you can, formally, you can say that K0 is equal to zero, okay, then, okay. But Nevertheless, it's just a convenient way to write the stuff, huh? Because at the end you have a k which is discontinuous in singular at zero, so you have a difficulty there, so you have to handle it anyway. That's not a very difficult point. So the existence and uniqueness is not so easy because of the singularity, but it was obtained by Ozada, let's say around 85, and there is also a result by Fombana and Martinez, which are two probabilists. Ozada is also a probabilist, I should say, of course. And they follow 10 something. And they follow, I could mention this argument because, in fact, they follow an argument by Marchioro and Pulvirenti, which was given for the Euler system of vertices, where they show that if the, okay, I forgot the vorticity which are there. If the vorticity are well chosen, and not in a set which is of measure zero, let's say, but the vorticity you can obtain, then this system exists for all time, meaning that there is no collision of vortices, okay? What is difficult to, there will be a problem in this system if two vortices came at the same position, where the kernel is singular. Okay? So what you need to avoid is collision of vortices.
Yes?
Yeah, omega is something which could be positive or negative. Yeah. But this is the last time it could be positive or negative, because right now I will always consider omega is equal to 1. Okay. From no one. Omega I is equal to 1 for all I. This is just for simplification. Okay. This is not a requirement. You can do what I will say later will work also with any possible omega I. It's more delicate to write. So I prefer to write the things in this particular case, because after that, else it will complicate the presentation of anything, and you won't like it, probably. So this system, I should mention that it's important from numerical vision, okay? This is a system that at least was highly used for numerical simulation, in particular of 2D turbulence and so on. I remember there was an article, by Schwerin in the 60s, or in the 70s, which showed that he used this kind of system with to simulate turbulence and so on. So it's an important system. It's not just we want to play about it. Okay? So what's the link with this system and the previous equation? Okay, as I said before, you say that more or less this is a system written at the level of the trajectories, and this is an equation. So this is a Lagrangian point of view, if you want, and this equation is for the Eulerian point of view. Okay, so if I want to understand what do one with respect to the other one, I have to go to the same point of view. Okay, either Eulerian or Lagrangian. Is Eulerian good? Okay, if I write the Eulerian point of view, I need to write in some sense an equation for this one, for the empirical measure associated to the particle system. Does I really want to do that? Yes, maybe you can. So it will begin like for the Euler equation, because you have the transport part, which is the same. Then, the diffusion, the Brownian creates diffusion, but there is a remainder, because this is an empirical measure, and this cannot understand diffusion, and there is an ugly term, which is small, but which is really ugly, which is a kind of issue, just to make you a fear of this, it's a kind of martingale with value in distribution space. Okay, it's a distributed valued martingale. So okay, it is small, but it's very delicate to handle. You do not really want to do that. Okay, so in fact, you do not do that. Okay. So what you do is better. What is better is to use the a Lagrangian formulation of this one. So saying what are the characteristics, what are the trajectory which are behind the Euler equation, Navier-Stokes 2D equation, incompressible. Okay, so you take what I will call a nonlinear stochastic differential diffusion equation, sorry, which is the trajectories of this one. So the trajectories of this one, you take a typical particles, and you say that these typical particles, okay, she evolves according to what? There is this transport term, okay, which is given by the kernel, so I can write it like this. Okay, plus a Brownian motion. Okay. If I do that, typically I have, which is given, so BI is always a Brownian motion. Okay, and where omega t, at this time, what is omega t? Omega t is a full vorticity of your system, and in some sense, it's also the distribution, the law of x of t. I should write it like that. I'm sorry, it's missing, there's something wrong there, and this is correct. Okay, and so you can write it also as an expectation if you want to do a little bit of probability, which I think it's a kind of interesting, so I just mention it also. Okay, meaning that here, so omega of t is the law of x of t. This notation is saying that omega of t, no, sorry. This is not the good one. Omega of t is the law of x of t, okay? And ey of t is an independent copy of xt, okay? So I mean basically just I wanted to use these two ways of writing the stuff, just meaning that you use the kernel on the full law of the system, and you can also see this. If you want, this is the law. So this is the law of y. Y of t is an independent copy of xt. Okay. So it means, in some sense, that to get the Navier-Stokes 2D equation, you need to make a typical particle, okay, with an independent copy of itself. So you choose among the all other possible particles which are at your time, and you choose one randomly, independently of the previous one you had. Okay. So at this time, you see what I mentioned before about propagation of chaos in this system, okay? It is fully what we want in some sense, okay? And what we have in a large system of particles, not infinite system of particles, is that in some sense, you pick all the other particles, and you cannot choose all the one you need that you pick up randomly and independently. You have to choose the all other one that you have. So your hope is that the other one is distributed according to independently or according to what you want. I will try to be more clear later. So you write this equation, which is NLSDE, okay? It is better in Lagrangian point of view. So you pass to this one. Okay. The last equation I will need to write is the Liouville equation. Okay. The Liouville equation, what is it? It is the equation satisfied by the law of the full system of particles. Okay. What is this equation? It is a huge equation because Fn will be the law of Xn, X1, Xt. And it is a kind of transport equation, but a huge one, because you have n particles which are following all these dynamics. So I should write a huge differentiate, a huge transport term, which is xi minus xj, gradient of xi of Fn equals to a sum of new sum of diffusion, because all the Brownian motion give some diffusion term, okay? Fn, okay? So what is the equation for Fn? Fn is the law of x1 n at Fn t is the law of x1 n at times t, x1 xn, I should write them like this one. So, okay, at times t, and it satisfies the Liouville equation. Okay, this is a huge equation. Okay. So we have the I write on the left hand side all the equation we need. So on what we need to prove now is what is called the propagation from what we call the propagation of chaos. Okay. Okay, but so we have this distinction that I try to explain that in the limit, in some sense, you interact with something which has the same law than you, but which is fully independent of you, okay? And in the n particle system, you interact with all the other particles which are in your system, which are not independent with you, okay? That's the point, because in fact, as long as you make evolve the systems, even if at time zero they are independent, then there is this interaction terms, which will create correlation, so you lose your independence. So so you say, okay, is this different? So no, it's not maybe you have a hope, okay, which is that, okay, they are interacting, but they see almost all, if as long as the empirical measure is close to something in common, you see that this should be close, this should be close to this formula in some sense, okay? So you should get this formula plus some correction. And if you hope that the corrections are small enough and do not create too much correlation, you will say something like that. Okay, I'm not fully independent. We are kind of close to independence. Okay, and if we are kind of close to independence, kind, in some sense close to independence, then probably we behave like this one. And if we behave like this one, then probably we preserve some kind of independence. Okay, so you want to propagate, in some sense, this independence in the system. This almost, this asymptotic independence, you want to propagate it to prove that, in fact, if the number of particles is large, then this should behave like this one, okay? But this is not so easy because the kernel is singular, okay? So even if you can believe that this sum is see the law of large number, and this sum is a kind of going when n is large to this one, for instance, okay, if you assume that all of this one are at this law, more or less, there is a singularity in the potential. Okay, so vortices which will cause, which will come close enough, then probably they could have a large influence on each other. Okay, and so imagine like if you know about the Boltzmann equation that Laurent de Villette explained before, when you look at the Boltzmann equation, you take two particles at random. You make them interact, and then after, they completely change their velocity, okay? After this time, these two particles, they are completely correlated, okay? They are really, I mean, there is strong correlation among them, okay? What we need if we want, in our case, we want to avoid this kind of situation in some sense, or maybe say that this may happen, but not too much, okay? You are correlated with, even you are smallly correlated to all the particles, or and maybe you are highly correlated to some particles, but not a large amount of them. Okay, we should say that this cannot happen. Both of this kind of stuff cannot happen, and we have this singularity. So we have to be careful when you do the computation. Okay, so now I should say explain a little bit what I mean by propagation of chaos is something like that. Okay, so I will try to draw a picture, and you start from a vorticity which is omega zero. You use one of the, this is the arrow of time, okay? So you use one of the result of existence of uniqueness to say that if omega zero is in L1, for instance, then you have a unique evolution for the NS2D equation, okay? And then you choose You start with n particles. With n particles that are, in some sense, omega n zero, okay, is 1/n sum of delta x n I at time zero, and you say that it is close to omega zero. And they are also more or less almost independent in some sense, okay? They are close to omega zero, let's say. And they are independent. In fact, what I will try to show is that there is this kind of interplay because being close to omega zero and being independent, which makes that you can preserve this one, both of them at the same time, if you want. Okay, you remains close. To omega t, and you remains almost independent. Okay. So this is a strange picture. Okay, what I want to say, I try to explain this, is that you have to, at the same time, remaining close to omega zero and being independent, you can in fact show that you propagate both in some sense at the same time. Okay, so but rigorously, what is rigorously the propagation of chaos? What is rigorously the chaos? So I need to get some definition. Chaos and propagation. So I will give a precise definition of what I mean by chaos. Okay, so I will take a sequence of a sequence of random variable, d'accord? But remark that just xn is a random variable which is in R2n, okay? At each time, at the step n, we have n random variables, okay? The size increases with n. You look at an increasing sequence. A sequence of random variables, at each time, the number of variables which is inside your huge vector increases by n. Okay, you say that xn is omega chaotic. Omega is a probability on R2, okay? If one of the three equivalent property below is true, which means that first I will say that the law for all k in n, an étoile, let's say, the law of the first k vector of xn. Go weakly as n goes to infinity to a tensorized version, the k-tensor product of omega. Okay, meaning that they have all these particles have distribution omega and are independent. Okay, if I put the tensor product here, means that they are independent. Their law is a product of law for each variable. Okay, second point is that k equals 2 only, meaning that you look only at the second marginal, xn1 and xn2, goes in law towards omega tensorized with itself one times as n goes to infinity. So, of course, point 1 implies point 2. This is not, this is quite trivial. And the second point is that you look at the empirical measure, the third point, sorry, is to look at the empirical measure. And you say that the empirical measure, which you can associate naturally to your vector of n particles, of n position, you construct an empirical measure. So you call it omega n, goes in probability towards what? Towards omega. And so this concerns the whole particle. I forgot something which is very important to say, is that the sequence of random vectors are exchangeable. Okay. Exchangeable meaning that if I permute, if I use a permutation among the xn, okay, then they still have the same law. Physically, we can also say that, in fact, you have unlabeled particles. Okay. You cannot say particle number one, particle number two. They are exchangeable in the sense that you cannot differentiate one to the second one and so on. Okay. So you have to use distribution which are symmetric, which are invariant with respect to permutation. Okay. So this is what we call propagation of chaos, which really means that when you pick two particles, then they are almost random. Okay, so there is two ways of saying this, either on the marginals. Marginals mean that you average on the position of many of the other particles, okay, or at the level of the empirical measure. Okay, they seem to be quite different, but on the strong assumption of exchangeability, this is something that you can see that it's equivalent in some sense. Okay, just to comment a little bit, for instance, if I say you that Wn is almost equal to W everywhere, almost surely. Okay. What you will say, what we can do about the second margin, the two particles marginal, okay? So you pick up on particles in this one, you fix it. And you ask yourself, what is the position of a second particle, of the second particles? So you know only the empirical measure, which is this one. But, so you know that all the other particles, they still are close to W0. You erase the first one, if you want. The small modification to do that, the position of the other one, the whole other one is still close to omega 0, okay? But if you are exchangeable, the position of the whole other particles is the same as the position of the second particle, in a sense. So knowing the full distribution on the other particle is close to omega 0, and the fact that there is exchangeability means in some sense that the second particle is still close to omega. Okay? In the other direction, you have a same kind of reasoning, because if you want to prove that this one goes in probability towards something which is deterministic, omega is fixed here, okay? This is a random object, a random variable, but this is deterministic. Then you just need the variance of this stuff around omega. And if you want to compute the variance on something, you just have to do the calculation, but you need only the two particle correlation to get some result about it. Okay. So this is really two different point of view, clearly, but under the magic of exchangeability, they become equivalent. Okay, that the very important point is there, that I should mention this one, that in this kind of system of particles, exchangeability is a key point, always. Okay, so this is chaos. This is a rigorous definition of chaos, okay? So meaning that in some sense, you are distributed according to roughly, let's say I should give a rough definition too. Okay, roughly this means that f law of xn is almost omega tensorized n times, okay? But this is, of course, this is very woof, because you cannot say something like that. The dimension increase, and so you have to measure it properly. And one way of measuring it is saying that the empirical measure goes to omega almost surely, and the other one is looking only at finite marginal of this stuff. Okay, and what is propagation of chaos? So propagation of chaos is saying that in the end, if I start from some initial distribution which are omega zero chaotic, okay, so you fix a distribution of particle which is omega zero chaotic from some well chosen omega zero, then you say that along times, what will happen Thus, the distribution at time t of my particle system will be omega t chaotic. Okay? You follow the dynamics of the particle systems, you follow the dynamic of the limit equation. Thus, they agree, again, at times t in the sense of chaoticity. Okay? The propagation of chaos is the following definition, is the following property. If xn zero is omega zero chaotic, does xn t is omega t chaotic, where with omega xn, xn t, this is the solution of the particle systems, okay, which is well defined thanks to the work I quote before, and with omega t solution of NS2D equation. I should mention also, in fact, that you could do a kind of trajectorial version of the propagation of chaos, okay? Meaning that the trajectory of this system goes are chaotic with respect to the trajectories of that system. But it is a kind of, you can follow the time if you want in this kind of system, but it is more complicated to write and to understand, so it's not the point here, but you can do something like that. Okay, so to complement my picture, which is there, I should write a line which I like very much, which means that exchangeability, okay, you start from exchangeable initial condition, and you expect that this is preserved a long times. Okay. This is, I mean, if you look at the equation, it is clear that if you change xy by xy, it will remain the permutation will still be true at times t. Okay, this is a general fact that if you want a right equation for indistinguishable particles, it's better for you that they preserve this exchangeability. If not, this is a kind of problem. Okay, so this is a general picture. I skip this one. Here is this. So the result about the systems regarding Navier-Stokes equation. Can we prove answer this question? The answer is yes. And I will quote two results. Okay. Two results. The first one is by Ozada. Published in 85. He said that yes, the answer is yes, but under some condition. The condition is the following one. Omega zero should be, the first one is that the viscosity is large enough. Okay, so you have to add something which is positive, but not only positive, greater than a constant, which is 1 over 2 pi or something like that. It's not really relevant. So the initial vorticity should be bounded. Okay, you start from IED initial configuration. So omega zero tensorized n times. Okay, so of course this is chaotic, but it is a particular sequence of chaotic, omega zero chaotic position. And then you get this result of propagation of chaos. Okay? The second one is the work we have done with Stéphane Michler, to put it in other order, Nicolas Fournier and myself, and which was published in JAMS in 2014, if I'm correct. The answer is still yes. But this is an improvement of this one, so I try to explain why. First, the improvement is that the vorticity has to be positive only. Okay. This is a good time to mention that if there is no viscosity, omega equals zero, this is the Euler equation, and you try to approximate the Euler equation, and this is really a mess, because the uniqueness result I mentioned on the limit equation, you do not have it anymore, so you have much less thing to say. If you are interested by this problem, there is maybe the best paper available as this of Chauchette, which studies the Euler, this kind of problem with no viscosity, but it's quite different. Okay, as you will see later, for instance, when I will try to give you the idea of the proof. So Michler, Fournier, Auré, we have any positive viscosity. Omega zero is just with finite entropy. Okay. With finite entropy. And xn zero is omega zero chaotic. So you have not to assume that initially they are independent. You just assume asymptotic independence. You just need a bound on the entropy of xn zero. Okay, the bound is on the entropy, and the entropy is an extensive quantity, as I will mention in a minute. So you to get something which is relevant, you have to divide it by n if you want to get something uniform in n. So this is the result. Okay, I will try to give you a sketch of the proof. Short sketch of the proof. Because, so just the sketch of the proof is classical, okay? What you want to do when you want to prove that something goes to a limit, okay? So there is several options. Either you are able to do estimates and to control anything and to get at the end some convergence with a weight, okay? Here, we are not in this kind of setting. We are not able to do that. We use some compactness argument, okay? So the first step is to get compactness. Compactness of the system, of the solutions, of the particle system, okay? Which is also, in probability, you called it tightness. Okay, this is the first step. The second step is to recognize the limit. Once you know compactness, you are able to extract subsequent steps. Converge, okay? That converges, and you want to recognize the limit, the possible limit. Sorry, this is too French. So you need to recognize the possible limits. And the first step, final step, is to say, if you want to say that, in fact, it's really converged, is uniqueness of the limit. Okay. So what about uniqueness of the limit? Okay. So just what I mentioned before is that uniqueness of the limit, this is a crucial point also, because I have this result of uniqueness if omega zero is in L1. So here we have something which has a finite entropy, so which is in L1 anyway. It's a probability, so it's okay. But there is a condition, a priori condition, you need to satisfy to be sure that your solution is unique among the solutions that are continuous in time after time zero, for instance. Okay, and this one, when you pass to the limit in a particle system, it's something which is very different. It's difficult to pass it to the limit. Okay, so there is still something to do there, because it will depend on what you are able to get on information on the possible limit. Not only that there are solutions of the equation, but some a priori information on them. Okay, so all of this point, what I should mention, it's heavily, all these points, heavily rely, all these points, heavily rely on the entropy dissipation and the properties of the Fisher information. On the entropy dissipation and the properties of the Fisher information. Okay. So what I mean by this? So in this system, I have the UVL equation, for instance, the Fokker-Planck evolution equation for the n particle system. What is the evolution of the entropy? Okay, so what I do is what I usually, maybe you saw it with Giuseppe Toscani just before, is that I write, in some sense, if you erase this term, you have a kind of heat equation, okay, in large dimension. But you will say that the evolution of the entropy will be given by minus, the derivative of the entropy will be minus the Fisher information of F. Okay, what does this term do? This term does nothing because K is divergence free. Okay, if it's divergence free, then you, in fact, you multiply by log of Fn, and you can pass it there, okay, because in fact, I should have written like a divergence, it's okay. Then this is a gradient of something, then you transform it as a divergence of this term because K is divergence free, okay, and then you integrate it and it becomes zero, okay. So when you look at the derivative with respect to time of f and t, of the entropy of f and t, it's equals, exactly equals. You are in the same as if it was the heat equation, okay? The Fisher information, ds, sorry, equals h fn zero. Okay, so you get that information. Okay, how can you pass to this information to give a given answer to the whole point? I will try to explain it in a few minutes, within a few minutes. So the first point, in fact, if you look at the equation, okay, this is a, you look at trajectories or say something which depends on time. So if you want some compactness, you want some compactness at fixed time, okay? And some continuity with respect to time, okay? To apply like a kind of Ascoli-Arzela-Ascoli theorem, okay? So the first point you need compactness at any time, at one time at least, but any time is better, if you, plus some uniform continuity in time. Okay, if you look at the equation, okay, what you need to control is the interaction term, which is singular. Okay, you if you want to integrate it in time, you need, if you want some continuity in time, you need to be able that this term integrated between two times is controlled by, for instance, its order of exponent, I don't know, something strictly positive. Okay, so to do that, if you work, you understand that you need to control something like that, basically. Believe me, okay? Typically, you need to control this term, okay? Integrated with respect to time, for instance. You need to control this term uniformly in N. Okay. Why? Because of exchangeability, you can write it only for two particles. It's the same things, okay? And if you work a bit, you say, and if you are familiar with the Hölder inequality, if you want to get that this term will be Hölder, this term is, the integral of this term is Hölder, means in some sense that if you can Hölder in time, you need to apply an under inequality in times to get something which is t minus s to the power, I don't know, some epsilon positive, and you get to control this one, okay? And this, as I would like to explain, but I have no time, so I will be woof, is you can control it by the Fisher information of xn1 s minus xn 2s. So why this? Meaning the law of the difference of two, the position of two particles. Why this? Just because, remark, because in fact, y of f, the Fisher information, if you look at this definition, you can write it like this one. okay, for instance. So this is a kind of Sobolev norm for square root of f, okay? So if you apply the Gagliardo-Nirenberg-Sobolev inequality, your Sobolev inequality, then you get some good integrability on f, okay? And in fact, what you get is that f in LP is controlled by some constants that I of f to the power 1 minus 1 over p if f is a probability, okay? For any p strictly larger than 1, not in between infinity, okay? So if you know this, then you are able to integrate this singularity in dimension 2, okay? In dimension 2, if you get all the LP norm, then you are able to integrate anything up to the 1 over x to the 1 over x to the square. This limit case not included. Okay, so you are able to control this one with respect to the sup in N of this Fisher information. Okay, and this Fisher information is the law of two, is smaller than the law of two particles. Okay, this because the Fisher information has very nice property. When you change the variables, you modify them. If you you have seen many of these very nice information properties in the TOEFL of Toscani, but there are many other properties of the Fisher information. One is, for instance, that you can control it by the Fisher information of the two particles, okay? And this, what is called a super additivity of the Fisher information, is that, in fact, when you take marginals of a distribution, the Fisher information decreases, okay? Fisher information, I mean the word information is exactly for that, okay? If you have n particles and you decide to look only at the three first particles, the information you get decreases, okay? This is an information. And this you can check, you can write it, you can do the calculation, but this is true. And it decreases, but in the sense of, and you can rescale it, okay? So this is smaller than the Fisher information of Fn. SGX. Okay? So with this one, and this is bounded. Okay? Because we if I rescale this inequality, I assume that this one was bounded. So this is bounded and this is bounded. To bound this, you have to bound this by below, in fact, but you can bound on my entropy is the mathematical entropy, not the one with the minus, the one with the plus. Okay, h of f equal integral of f ln the f. And on the whole space, it's not bounded by below, but if you have some moments of second order moments which are easy to propagate here, you can bound it by below. So if you, this is bounded, this is bounded by below, and this is bounded uniformly in N, and this allow you to handle the singularity and to do the first step, meaning showing the compactness. Okay? The second step, I just will skip it because it's kind of complicated argument, but you need the same estimate in some sense. Okay? You write, if you are familiar with that, you write the martingale formulation of this kind of limit system. Okay? How to recognize a trajectory which satisfies that, you use a martingale formulation of this one and you pass to, you see what I've, and you need to control terms like that. Okay, so you can do it with the same estimate. So you recognize the limit. So the next step, I need 2 minutes to conclude this step, okay, is that you need to recognize that the possible limits are solution of the NS2D equation, okay? So it's not finished because you have uniqueness if you get some extra information. And there is still a very nice property of the Fisher information, which I should write briefly, is that when you pass to the limit in some sense, it's a kind of gamma convergence of the Fisher information, which is that when you have particles xn such that, so n, a sequence of part distribution such that xn, no, so, sorry, the associated empirical measure goes in law toward the omega, but this time maybe random. Okay? This is the full general case. So you have the sequence of probability is not chaotic. To what it could converge the empirical measure to a probability, because these are probability on RD, and R2, these are converging law towards some probability on R2. Okay, then what you get is that, the mean of the Fisher information of omega is smaller than the lim-inf as n goes to infinity of the Fisher information of your particle system, of your particles, n particles. Okay? This is a kind of gamma convergence result because in some sense, if you use the tensorite, fine, there is a way to get the equality if you want. But anyway, you know to pass to the limit in the Fisher information too. Okay? When you look at some sequence of empirical measure going in the limit towards something, you can pass to the limit. And this is crucial for us, okay, because we have, after step two, we know that we converge, but maybe there is many limit points, okay, so we can converge towards something random. But what we get in the limit, that we can converge only towards a solution of the equation which have a bounds on the Fisher information integrated in times. Okay, and the last result is that you have uniqueness for such kind of system of solution of, fine. If you have this a priori condition, so uniqueness in NS2D, if omega zero is L1, and L1, okay, and the Fisher information is bounded. Because from this condition, you can do the trick of Dipper-Nanos to renormalize solution and to show that they are continuous in time with respect to blah, blah, blah. Okay, so this is the procedure. And what I will just to conclude to say that, in fact, so this again heavily relies on the very nice property of this entropy and Fisher information. Okay, at any step, you use these strong properties on this one. And as I mentioned, to conclude, and in fact, it's, for instance, the first step is a very important one, is that this Fisher information is extensive, okay? Meaning that when you add n particles, it behaves more or less like n times something, okay? It's extensive in the physical sense. And this is very important to use extensive quantity when you want to pass to the limit as the number of particles goes to infinity. For instance, Laurent Desvillettes in his talk, he used entropy, which are any L2 norm or something like that, because, you know, He works at a fixed number of particles and this behaves very well. But if you use L2 norms with an increasing number of particles, then this is a mess because basically, except of multiplying by n your estimates, you have this power n which appears in your L2 norm or something, and you will never be able to do something like that. No, I'm sure. But I strongly recommend that you need to use extensive quantity. That's why I think the talk of Toscani was really interesting, is that unfortunately, there is a few quantity which are extensive, which are not important. So we probably need more to get some better results and a more deeper result of convergence of particle system. So it's finished. Thank you. It's finished, yeah.
Let's take a question.